In this video, we're going to solve the heat equation on an interval from 0 to L. And we're going to do it with Fourier series and diagonalization. And in fact, this is where Fourier series came from. Fourier was studying the following problem. Suppose that we have a bar of length L, metal bar, and maybe you put a match to it and there's a flame and that heats up the middle of the bar. And so suddenly the center of the bar is really hot. But the ends of the bar are fixed. They're attached to some heat baths, so their temperatures are fixed. So you got a very hot middle of the bar, and the distribution of temperature is something or other, and you want to understand what happens as the bar cools off. The heat's eventually going to flow out the ends into the reservoirs, and eventually you're going to get a bar that's at room temperature. But how does it get there? So we define the function f of x t to be the temperature above, the excess temperature, how hot it is compared to room temperature at a position x and at time t. Now, because of the reservoirs, the excess temperature at the two ends is always zero because they're in contact with the heat baths that are held at room temperature. And the heat equation tells you that the derivative of the temperature at any given point with respect to time is proportional to the second derivative with respect to position. D is just a constant. This is the same equation that governs diffusion as well. Now, we're not going to derive the heat equation, but we are going to see how to solve it. And we're going to do it using the second perspective, where we think of f at any given time as a function of x. So we don't think of f as a function of x and t. We think of it as a function of x that evolves in time. So from that perspective, we have that the derivative of the function with respect to time is an operator acting on that function. And that operator is this constant d times the second derivative. And we want to solve equations like this. This should remind you of dx dt equals a matrix times x. And you solve that by finding the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the matrix. Likewise, we want to find the eigenvectors and eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the second derivative operator, and we already did that in an earlier video. The eigenvalues are minus n squared pi squared over l squared times this constant d, and the eigenvectors are just sine n pi x over l. They're the Fourier modes. So the way to solve an equation derivative equals matrix times x is you write a linear combination of the eigenvectors times an exponential of the eigenvalue times time. It's the same thing for if you work in a big space, our vector f as a function of time is going to be a linear combination of the eigenvectors times e to the lambda t, where here's lambda and here's the eigenvector. Now, all the eigenvalues are negative. That means the situation is stable. All of the terms go to zero, and they go to zero exponentially fast. The one that goes to zero the slowest is lambda 1. It's minus pi squared d over l squared. And so that is the dominant eigenvector. So even if you start off with some crazy function, after a little while, you'll have mostly the first mode. So in general, here's our most general solution. F, we said that F was a linear combination. It was a constant times the exponential times time times the eigenvector. If we spell that out, it says F of x t is some unknown constant times e to the minus n squared pi squared d over l squared times time times the sine wave. And how do we figure out the constant? Well, we just plug in what happens at t equals 0. Our function at t equals 0, these exponentials are all 0, so you get cn sine of n pi x over l. Well, you know how to figure out what cn is then. You do it by doing an inner product, which is an integral. So for example, let's suppose that we started off with the temperature being room temperature at the two ends but hotter in the middle. So the extra heat, for simplicity, we're going to take the L to be 1 and D to be 1. And the extra heat is x up until x equals a half, and then it's 1 minus x and comes back down to 0. Well, to figure out what C n, we have to take the integral from 0 to 1 of this function times sine of n pi x over L. Don't have to divide by L because L is 1. And that's the integral from 0 to a half of x times sine, plus the integral from a half to 1 of 1 minus x times sine. And I'm not going to do the integrals here. You can find the details in section 6.9 of my book. This is example 2. And the answer comes out to 4 over n squared pi squared sine n pi over 2. And if n is 1, 5, 9, 13, etc., then it winds up being 4 over n squared pi squared. If it's 3, 7, 11, 15, it's negative 4 over n squared pi squared. And if n is even, it gives you 0. So those are the coefficients. And so we get that our function over time is given by this expression. It's the coefficient times the exponential times the function. Now, if you look at how this behaves, the term where n equals 1 decays the slowest, and all the other terms shrink way, way faster than the n equals 1 term. There is no n equals 2 term because the coefficient is 0, and the n equals 3 term has an eigenvalue that's 9 times as big as the n equals 1 term, so it decays 9 times faster. So after a little while, you're left with something that looks basically like just the first term. It shrinks away. It shrinks away to zero. But after a while, the residual heat is distributed like a sine wave, and it decays like e to the minus pi squared t. Now, we've done this all from the dynamic perspective, thinking of a function of x and t as a function of x that evolves in time. You can also look at it from the static perspective. From the static perspective, we're looking at functions on the interval from 0 to L cross times that go from 0 to infinity. The boundary conditions are that f of 0t and f of lt are always 0. And we're looking at the operator derivative minus d time, derivative with respect to t minus d times second derivative with respect to x. And what we're, you know, solving the heat equation is the same thing as finding the kernel of B. And what we wanted to do was find a basis for that kernel. These are all solutions to the wave equation. The most general solution to the wave equation is a linear combination of these functions. And that's exactly what we saw earlier. The most general solution is a linear combination of these functions.